before we even get started with that.
Have we pressed the go yet?
Yeah, we're Did we press the go? Okay, the question that literally
you
just...
You never know here. saying.
Just popped into my head. Have you ever been asked to do a cameo? Like in any of the TV shows or films?
No. And I don't think I would.
Because why?
I think it's sort of embarrassing when Stan comes on and he does that little, you know, the night watchman or some shit.
Hey, true believers.
The bus driver or whatever. I think if I did one, I'd have to get a part. It'd have to be a part in the movie.
Is it like how Kevin Conroy just did Batman in the Crisis show?
Did he?
Yeah.
I didn't see it.
He played...
Was he a character?
He was literally Bruce Wayne. Yeah, okay. He was Batman.
So I think that's... I would rather that.
Oh, that would be awesome.
Wouldn't that be good? Like, you know, I can do it.
Who would you want to play?
I don't know. That's an interesting question. My friend Larry Hama did a kind of semi-Asian movie.
Oh, he did?
And I was a character in the movie.
Oh, okay.
I've shot a film myself, and I was a character in the movie. I was the young, handsome father.
There you go.
Did it say that in the credits? Young handsome father.
He's like, there I am. That's okay.
But no, I've done some acting, and if I'm gonna do it, I don't want to be, you know, the butt of a joke.
Yeah.
I would rather be a character in the movie that I get to slug somebody.
That makes sense.
Standard Robert Redford.
Yeah.
I didn't know you're so short. he used to be the handsome guy, you know. Suddenly he's like this short guy.
He's the head of Hydra.
He's the head of Hydra, but he's like small.
Yeah, I actually didn't know he was that small.
I'm just saying, you know. I mean, I for all I know, I'm the same age, but he goes out in the sun and they get him all leathery.
Yeah.
You know, it looks like, you're like, whoa, born. Born and short. I like the guy. I think he does a great job. But it looks worn out and short. I want to hit somebody. Would you?
Yeah. That would be awesome.
Yeah, definitely true.
I don't mind going out, but let me hit somebody first. I'd rather play a part. That would be cool.
What about I'm not saying that because you're one of the fathers of Batman, but like, would you want to be in a particularly a Batman project or?
I don't care. Whatever.
Okay.
How about, oh, I got it. How about like a criminal's getting away from Batman and then they run into you and you just like deck them?
That's what a younger Stan Lee would do. That's a guy who decks somebody. That's not.
But no, I mean like that's just your introduction to your character.
I would rather be a character. I would rather either be a bad guy or a good guy.
Like a mob boss that like Batman goes and it's like Falcone. You.
Oh, we might be giving away too much here.
You know, things change as time only runs forward.
Yeah.
Shit happens in the future that you never expect will happen, and suddenly, oh shit, he's playing a part. He's in a movie. What's the deal? Who expected Stan Lee to show up in all these parts?
Nobody.
Who expected that? And it was great. You know, it was a lot of fun. Anyway,
it became a thing you started to look for. So then it's just like,
yeah. Now you had to see it. You know, I think they're doing robot versions of Stan now.
Oh really?
I'm lying.
I was like, wait. He knows something.
It's like Arnold Schwarzenegger. You know, that's Stan. The Night Watchman isn't dead. No, I'm saying. It's weird. I think, anyway. Let's move on. We're getting to deep waters here, guys.
Onwards. We're here to talk about, once again, just the return of Fanfare NYC.
Yes.
The 2020.
It would happen again. I did because they did such a good job last year.
Yeah.
I mean, who expected that to be so good? It was like a convention.
Yeah.
We're in New York, right? We have one of the only high schools that basically a vocational high school that teaches art. Okay. Where else do you have that as high school, right?
Not many places.
Have a convention in the school. Who has that? Nobody. Yeah, you can go to Chicago, you go to LA, you go anywhere, you go anywhere in the world. You can't have that.
Only in New York.
And only in New York. I mean, my daughter-in-law, sorry. Right here.
It's just the cue card.
Sorry, Adams, right there. She's not sorry, but sorry. I'm not saying she's doing it all because then other people get pissed at me for saying that. But she's the spark plug of that whole convention. She's put so much together. She gets guests. She gets publicizes it. She's out there. And last year, you know, I thought, well, you know, I'm going to have some little booth, you know, where I'm going to show my little volcanic science project and make the volcano go, you know, and dribble down the side of the volcano or whatever the hell that is. And it was a regular convention.
It wasn't
like a convention, but it was like a big deal school. You think you'd look at it at a university.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
You know, and it was great. And there were rooms. I didn't even know they had these other rooms.
Yeah, there was like
people out there. They're gonna have a Star Wars sword fight thing. What do you call it?
Workshop. Yeah.
The lightsaber training.
Very excited.
Who would expect that? I'm just like, wow, it's gonna be. And from the sound of it, it's gonna be better than last year. Anybody who graduated that school, if you're an idiot if you don't come, first because it's your school.
Okay? Exactly.
But beyond that, it's not just a throwaway. It's not like, oh, we'll go down and see what it's like, and it'll be a piece of boo. And you go down, and it's something. We had the guy who did Mouse last year.
Yeah, I'm blanking on his name at the moment.
Yeah, we're all blanking on his name. I just brought it up. We don't have Marilyn. Marilyn, who did Mouse? Hey, guys, who did Mouse?
Art Spiegelman, thank you.
Name.
And he was vaping. Pissed me off. Comes over to visit me at my booth and he's vaping.
He was vaping? I didn't see that.
Boy, stay away from me with that stuff.
It's like the cool new cigarette, but it looks like some machine or something.
Apparently it's terribly dangerous.
It definitely is.
But Art was there, and who expected that? I didn't expect. I guess he was a graduate. There's lots of people who are graduates, but beyond that, New York Pride, for God's sake, you know?
Yeah.
Come on down, you know.
And it's cheap. It's like 15 bucks.
$15. It's cheaper than any convention you're going to go to.
You think about Comic-Con is $60 a day. Yeah. This convention is $20 for the weekend.
Yeah, and you get, what, 100,000 people going to Comic-Con? Okay, come on down, guys. I mean, you can come down from Westchester. It's good. Get down. I'm saying.
There's a train to here.
That's
very
right.
Easily. You can get here.
And a lot of those people are probably future Marvel, DC, Image, writers, artists.
You got writers and artists, and you can run into writers and artists. They're giving classes and seminars. I got a whole list of stuff here. I would read it to you guys.
We'll add that on screen.
But it's a lot. It's a lot. And they have portfolio reviews. They've got classes. They've got these. And like I said, when I was there last year, we're in this big, I guess it was a lunchroom. I'm in the back of the lunchroom, right? And I thought that was it.
Yeah.
Art Spiegelman's up there. I'm over here, and a lot of people in here. I get up and I walk down, and there's a whole thing down there. It's all these other booths and stuff. It's just in the gymnasium, right?
Yeah, it's on different floors.
Right.
Too.
It's a convention. It's really a convention. I've been to conventions that are smaller than that a lot of times.
Those ones are like hotels or something, and they're just like in a conference room.
That one in the hotel that Carbonaro has was smaller.
Yeah. In Hotel Pennsylvania. Yeah.
No. This year he had it on 34th Street. That's over. I forget what it's called. Whatever it's called. Stop looking at your phone.
I'm looking at the event.
But this event, this is bigger. I would say twice the size.
Yeah,
twice the size and more fun, and you gotta come.
So why do you think this has been something that, and now it's something that's being tied into the very like DNA of the school? Like, why do you feel it's so important for the students, you know, who are getting this experience to do this, like to, you know, creativity on top of entrepreneurship?
You have to understand that, just to give you a sense of history, we don't have illustrators. We used to have illustrators in America. We had Norman Rockwell, we had Rockwell Kent, we had all these illustrators that would illustrate for the magazines, the New York Post, Life Magazine, Look Magazine. And these illustrators would illustrate historic events or do the covers or paint the covers. Well, we don't have magazines like that anymore.
Yeah, no.
Where are the illustrators going? Drew Struzan was probably the greatest movie poster illustrator of all. Still around, okay. But what happened in Hollywood is the agents decided that they wanted their actors to appear on the movie posters in photographs. So suddenly, the illustrator painters are not doing movie posters anymore, even the ones who can do perfect likenesses like Drew Struzan. So Drew Struzan, who did Raiders of the Lost Ark,
Star Wars,
who did that Back to the Future,
yeah,
did Goonies,
yeah,
who did tons and tons of movie posters, Tarzan. He's not doing movie posters anymore. They just stopped, and one day it just ended. All the agents said, "No, we want photographs," and now they're all boring. One
just
boring.
Images of people really, with like Photoshop basically,
and that, you know, how much Photoshop do you have to do? Here's some leaves, put a lot of leaves over here.
They're standing in an empty blank room with a green screen, and then now you're
right. So, and how many and you actually look at it, you know, as an art student, you look at it, you go, they took this on a different day than they took this. Looking at the lighting, you know, you're going, oh, this guy wasn't using the same lighting. This guy must have been in like another town or somewhere. You know, took a photograph of him. He's got blue on him, and this guy's got a little richer color, and this guy's lit three-quarter this way. And it's like, and you look at it, they don't go together. You know, why don't you shoot them on the same day? Oh, you couldn't get them together. So it's crappy movie posters, and because of the agents, no offense, guys, you agents are jerks. No offense. We now have no movie posters by great illustrators, and so we have, where do the artists go? Where do America's artists go? Comic books.
Yeah.
Right?
Alex Ross.
Right. They're fantastic illustrators doing comic books all the time. And if you don't do it for the big company, you do it for a small company. You do it for yourself.
Yeah,
and you go to conventions and you got comic books that don't even appear on the news in the comic book stores. You can buy them at conventions. Sure. So these guys travel the circuit. They go to these different conventions and their tables are full of comic books and other stuff, and they can now ply their ware at comic book conventions as well as in the stores. If they can't get them to the stores, they sell them to conventions. I sit and I talk to these guys all the time, and I say, well, are you distributed through Diamond? They say no, and Diamond's like a monopoly.
Yeah.
And so I say, you get, they say no. I say, well, how are you doing? They say, well, okay, we're doing good. We're doing really good. I say, well, okay, come on. How many copies are you printing? Well, we're printing 2,000 copies. That's $5 a shot. Okay, so that's not a lot of money, but maybe it pays the airfare. And maybe you have other product at your table and you do other stuff as well. You do working with other comic book guys. And so they put enough together so they can have a table and they sell the stuff and they make a buck. Maybe they don't get rich, but they're doing what they like to do.
Yeah,
so
they're learning.
So the freedom to do the quality that you think you can do, whether it's any good or isn't any good, then what happens is you get the artists who can do comic books, who are really good at doing comic books, and they fall off, and now they're doing storyboards for movies. So I had a guy who was doing Sam Marie for me. He's now doing movie work, big in Hollywood. But these are trained guys. I mean, I trained this guy myself. He's a trained artist, and he does stuff that 20 years ago nobody would do. I mean, they didn't even do science fiction. I used to do, to give you an idea. Marvel Comics was run by a company that had magazines. They basically had men's magazines. And in men's magazines, they had men's magazines, you'd have sailors who were kidnapped by Nazis, Nazi girl pirates that had swastikas on their breasts.
Wow.
Stupid. Stupid shit. Okay.
That appeared later. So it was a silencer character, wasn't it?
Well, no. They had swastikas on their breasts. Anyway, so... Now, okay, so these men's magazines, they had illustrators doing that stuff, and the illustrators would take pictures of people in a room, you know, holding whips and posing stupidly and ridiculously, and they would do the illustrations for the magazines called men's magazines, and they were busy work for illustrators. They would also do book covers, okay, not Frazetta level book covers, but book covers of posed guys in suits, you know, James Bond and crap like that.
Mm-hmm.
So they the company that was Marvel was Timely, right? They were doing these magazines, men's magazines, and then they also did comic books, which was Timely, which became Marvel. Mm-hmm. Okay. So Stan Lee went to his uncle who ran the company, okay, Martin Goodman, and he said, I want to do some magazines, like the men's magazines. So I want to do a slick cover magazine, but on newsprint, on the inside. Mm-hmm. So do these magazines. So we want to do Conan. He did Crazy Magazine. He did Kung Fu Magazine. He did a science fiction magazine. Okay. So all the insides were black and white, newsprint, like the men's magazines. Or maybe one color, or they would have some little color sections. But they would have a slick wraparound cover that had to be an illustration, not a comic book drawing. Okay? Hmm. So now they're going to do martial arts, kung fu. So they're going to call it kung fu, right? Who's going to paint that? Who's going to paint that cover? Because you got guys who pose people in a room. They don't know anything about martial arts. Then you got guys who draw comic books. They don't know anything about painting. So who's going to do those covers? Me.
Mm.
Because I paint. I know martial arts. I can do it. I know the movies that are out there. I go to them, right?
Yeah.
I see every movie that Bruce Lee ever made.
Yeah.
Or Jackie Chan or anybody, right? So I know all that stuff. I did work with a producer who was making those magazines, those movies in New York. So we did Street Fighter and all these, you know. We switched from buying Asian movies to having black and Puerto Rican guys doing movies here,
mm-hmm.
right? And so I could do that stuff. So now Marvel wants to do these magazines. How are they going to do the covers? How are they going to do a science fiction cover? Who knows science fiction that's an illustrator? Who knows martial arts? Who can do lampooning? I mean, who went to see Billy Jack? I did. And I can paint it. And I can draw it. And I get it. So every time, and who knows Conan? Who can paint Conan? Not Barry Windsor Smith. He can't paint. John Buscema can paint, but he paints quiet. You know? So now I'm doing Conan covers, painted Conan covers. I did three. I did Bruce Lee, because there were no illustrators in those days who could paint and knew all those subjects. I mean, they could paint, but they didn't know the subject. They didn't know martial arts.
Wow, that just seems like
that's unbelievable.
You'd think you'd find a dozen of them. No, you couldn't find any. So each new genre that they would do over at Marvel, I would have to do the first bunch of covers, until they could get some people that they could kind of slug in there that might fit into the genre and be able to do it. I had to do the covers. Then when it's science fiction, I had to do the cover. First cover, they did, what did we say? Science fiction, martial arts, mm-hmm. and what? Something else.
Oh, goodness.
anyway, but they basically just had me do the covers until mm-hmm. other people could do it. Nowadays, you got illustrators that can do anything.
Yeah.
They're coming out of the woodwork. Whether they're painters, they're artists, whatever they are, and the United States is recruiting them from all over the world.
Yeah.
They're not just Americans. Used to be comic books were done by Jewish kids in the Lower East Side. That was it. It was all Jewish, and they were all from the Lower East Side because, I don't know, you go down the block and there they are.
There was someone just out there drawing.
You didn't travel to Kansas to get a young artist. You didn't go to California. You just, these kids walking around with portfolios. That was it. But now, we got artists from Czechoslovakia, artists from South America, artists from Australia, names you can't even pronounce. It's acrobic.
I can
barely pronounce that. And they're from everywhere. So the world is, the comic book medium has absorbed all the young artists from everywhere, not just New York, from the whole world.
The world, yeah.
And the whole world wants to have a school like the School of Art and Design.
Do you think the School of Art and Design helped you build that foundation?
Yeah, because it was an art school. Remember, they had this thing in back in the day and during Roosevelt where they had started this idea of vocational high schools.
Yeah. Yes.
So you go to a a university and you study to become a lawyer or study to become a doctor or whatever the hell it is, or you go to an art school and study, on a very high level, you get to be an artist. But I'm a teenager, and my friends are teenagers. We don't want to wait to go to college. We can't even afford to go to college, or won't get the opportunity. So what do we do? Here's a high school that teaches art. High school. There's a heart that teaches a high school that teaches metal trades. There's a high school that teaches automotive engineering. There's high schools that teach all these things, and they're called vocational high schools.
Yeah.
Well, vocational high school is magic for somebody who wants to learn fast. And if you're a prodigy, if you're one of those top-tier people that is going to make it young, where can you go? You're in high school, and you're stuck. I got 4 years in three or 4 years in high school, and I'm stuck until I can go to college. And then maybe I can learn something about art. A little late.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
A little late. When I got out of high school, I just turned 18. Mm-hmm. Just turned 18, and I could go into the world, and I could make a living drawing pictures. I have a book up on my bridge up there, a little notebook, that shows how, when I just got out of high school, what I made that week, what I made the week after that, what I made the week after that, week after that, week after that. Every dime that I could make just to get away from getting a real job.
That's like, but it is, I still consider it though a real job as well. I mean, it's a lot of work.
No, it's a real job, but I mean a real job, you know, where you go and you put in the hours. And
your typical 9-to-5.
Yeah,
you know.
No, that's, I didn't want that. I wanted to be able to draw. Somebody give me money to draw a picture. Just that's all, man.
That's a dream, man.
It is. So why do we have a school like this? We have this incredible vocational. It's not just a high school. It's a vocational high school. Half the time you spend in there, half the periods you spend in art, half the period you spend in regular classes.
Yeah.
And we got to learn
English and
all the rest of that stuff. Academics.
Yeah.
You have to do that in order to get the four periods. Well, that's fine with me. I'll do that. I don't mind learning stuff. You know, but I want to learn art. And even the first year they broke up the school. I don't know how they do it now, but probably do it very similar. In the first year, they break you up. So you do sculpting, you do watercolor, you do this, you do that. You get four different classes that you do for the first year. And so you can, if you had choices, you might say, hey, I'm a little more interested in watercolor, interested in this. Maybe I'm interested in that. So they're giving you choices. Drove me crazy. I knew what I wanted to do, draw comic books. But they made me do this other stuff, but I now know this other stuff. Mm. Now I'm a good watercolorist. Now I do good fashion art. Now I do good sculpting. Now I do all those things that I learned in the first year, and I've turned them into a way to make a living in case I have to turn to it or in case I want to be consulted. That and other things that they also even had some engineering classes, how to do blueprints. They had a class that taught me that, man. It was great. I was like, if somebody said, lay out your, I have a studio in LA. I made the blueprint for it. All this stuff is in high school.
I'm thinking that, like high school.
High school.
I didn't learn stuff in my high school.
I took maybe two art classes. That's about.
This is great. So you got kids that'll graduate this, and they don't have to go to college, and then maybe they don't want to go to college. Maybe they want to come into the field right away. Maybe they're talented enough. If they're not, there are other choices to make. But who has that? Nobody.
Yeah.
I don't know. I was told there was a vocational high school somewhere in the Midwest. I don't know what it is. The only one I know of is this one.
School of Art. You leave there fully prepared with
If you're not capable of doing it, then you can go to college or then you do something else.
Yeah.
But if you got a Drew Struzan, if you got a Norman Rockwell, this is the perfect place to go to. If you're a prodigy, let's say, where do you go?
I think it's great too that like when we went last year, to see the students with their own booths and have everything all set up. I don't know it, again, as you said, I don't know anywhere else in the country where you're going to find a school where these kids who might be in like 9th or 10th grade and they're making their own money.
That's right,
of their own artwork, and it's like that experience very early on.
Right.
It's like,
right.
I could sell
this. Then they can learn a little bit about business. Yeah. I mean, one of the things that I'm pushing very hard with the school as much as possible is you have to learn about business, because when you learn about business, you're also able to comport yourself in the business world so that you know how to sell your stuff.
Yes.
And you know how not to get ripped off.
Yes.
Very easy to get ripped off. Very easy not to pay your taxes.
Yes.
little things like that you got to pay attention to, because you know, they come and get you and mess you up.
I actually, on the last episode we did with you for Fanfaire, you taught us very much about like business, and we still
got a new job because of that.
Like that, it literally.
I used the salary thing where it works so well. Hopefully, they never see this.
No, they never will, because they don't care. And it worked.
And it works. Yes.
I'm telling you.
I'll
tell it to anybody.
You know, another,
like it really,
I remember the word.
Fanfaire isn't just great, I'd say, also for the students, but, you know, last year we met a lot of exhibitors who this also gives an opportunity to get their work out there in the world, too.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Right. No, there's no downside to this. I mean, it's the greatest thing in the world. And if you want to know what your kids are doing, and you want to know where the creative outlet for the future is, this is it. This is it. Remember we went from farms to factory,
mm-hmm.
and now we're entrepreneurs.
Yeah.
And you know, people complain about, oh, they're shipping the jobs to India. No, those are jobs we don't want. We don't want to do that. We want to take our microphones and our cameras and go videotape stuff.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
But there's no tape involved. We're all digital.
Yeah, so.
Yeah.
And we can do shit that nobody else that couldn't do in the previous generations. We want that opportunity to do that, and that's what we're doing in America. We're actually showing the world how to be entrepreneurial geniuses. And yeah. We don't even have to be geniuses. We just have to be just a little bit smart.
Yeah, exactly. Smart just enough. Slightly.
Just a little smart.
That's
just
like that joke, like how fast you have to be to outrun a lion. And she's like, just faster than the other guy.
Faster than that guy over there. But people don't make enough of it. They talk about there's this little town and all the jobs were taken away. And then they go and interview the people. And the people say, oh, we're doing terrible. But we do have this little bakery shop. Really? Oh, yeah. Well, it's just a little one. We'll see how it's going. Oh, yeah. We were thrown out of work. But we're doing this thing on the internet. And we seem to be doing okay. Really? Is that it? Is that what's going on? Yeah. Well, you got to make money somehow. You know, we do this and we do that. We start this little community thing, and suddenly they're thinking of new ways to make money in their own communities, and they're probably not going to go back to that job if that factory opens up again. Screw that.
Yeah,
I'm making more money this way. And people are finding these things everywhere, and they're doing these things, and they're making these things. Well, think of what it's like to be an artist.
Yeah,
you know, if you can draw, there's people out there that want you.
They want that work.
That's
yes.
right. And there's stuff you can do that's your own, and maybe you own it, and maybe they make a movie about it. You see what I mean? And it's just so much. And this is the hotbed of that. That's where this is. You go there and you get students, and they're laughing and having a good time. Meanwhile, you look at the table and go, that's pretty good. That's pretty good there. Not bad. Mm-hmm. I bet you could do work in
that's
suddenly. Stuff's going on, and I'm just saying that in a normal high school you got to wait till you go to college, really, and then you get a job in a corporation. We're bored with that. We really kind of are. You know, I think it's great with those guys with the suits, you know, and they just like wearing the ties and wearing the suits and stuff, and they try to impress each other, and they drink their lunch and it's booze, and nobody cares, and they have opinions, but it's all, you know. Where are you going to go? What country club are you going to go to? And did you buy the boat? And blah, blah, blah. And those same people, they'll come to comic book convention, they'll buy comic book art, original comic book art, just to put something on their wall because they got crap. And why are you buying comic book art? Oh, it's a coming thing. It's cool. And I really like to look at it. Yeah?
That's it?
You put it in your yacht.
Yeah, exactly. It's like right there. Like, oh.
Because this entrepreneur concept goes everywhere, and you don't. Give you an idea. It used to be, when people had made a lot of money, okay,
mm-hmm.
they would dress like they made a lot of money, and you could spot them. Now people who are make a lot of money, they're dressing jeans, yes, torn t-shirts,
sweatpants.
They just look like they look like everybody else.
Yeah.
If I got if I'm at a convention, right, and somebody comes up, and I have like my portfolio of covers and stuff, this stuff that sells for $10,000 and $20,000, and somebody goes and looks at it, I can't tell if that guy's rich or just somebody who's looking yep. through the portfolio. So I got to treat him really well because he could be some rich guy with some scraggly beard, you know, like those guys in the Ozarks. And it
mm-hmm.
looks like. And you go and you say, that's you know, that's $15,000. I say, yeah, how much is this one? Oh, really? How much is this one? Yeah, well, you know, I'm into original art. Really? Let's talk.
Like, please come sit down. Have a seat.
Have a seat.
Yeah. Like, this is the cheap stuff. Let me
show you. I got some stuff back here. You like to take a look at that. And suddenly, you know, and this guy's got a torn T-shirt. You can't spot him because yeah. nobody cares anymore.
Exactly.
If they want to wear a torn T-shirt, they wear. I can't tell the rich guys. You can't.
You can't. There's no difference.
Well, even the guys who, you know, what's that, the guy with the beard and stuff, he wants to fly to Mars or fly out in space. Branson.
Branson.
Looks
yeah.
like a guy, man. He doesn't look like a rich guy. He looks like a guy. Just a guy. And they're all like that. All those guys, the guys who run the big corporations, that kid who shaves his head, I forget what his name, one of the richest guys in the world. Looks like some punk you want to bump into.
That's like, what's his name? Ed Sheeran. That's like, he looks like he works in a library. But this guy's a multi-million dollar singer.
Right. Start singing, you're like, whoa, what's going on?
That's the way it is now. I mean, it's great, and those kids, you know, you walk into this convention, and you walk by some kid's table, and you go, and the kid's having a good time, or maybe a girl or a guy, and they're giggling and having a good time with their friends. And then you look at the table, and like I said, that guy, that kid, make a lot of money.
Yeah, you see the talent, and you're
there,
like,
it's right there. It's like,
it's like, what grade are you in?
How old are you? That's good.
You also get to, like,
a couple years later,
you get to see, like, the person, too, not just their artwork, but sometimes, like, the individual personality,
yeah.
all
yeah.
that they have it all,
right,
you know?
Right.
So.
And you want that, to happen. You want that's what you want your kids. Look at. If you get your kid into a school like that, it's like giving him the world. Really, it's like the opportunity is there. If you blow it, you screw it up. Then you blow it, you screw it up. But if you make something out of it, this is how you do it. It was called then the School of Industrial Arts. My mother found it. She knew I was interested in art. I was drawing comic book stuff all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And she knew I was interested. She found it. My mother only went to third grade.
Wow.
So she bought and sold rooming houses, and I did all the work in the rooming houses. I painted and I built and I did everything. And she found this school. I didn't think such a thing existed. Where the test for going into the school is you draw people in a park. That was the test. You draw people in Central Park. Really? That was the test? I can do that.
He's like, I'm going to put Batman here, and I'm going to put
and that's the kind of a place it is. That's so original and creative and fantastic that, you know, you want, if there's anybody out there watching this, if you want to go and have a good time and see what the future is, this which one?
Fanfaire NYC.
A fan convention in a high school. Hello? What is that? When did that ever happen in the world? Never.
What is this the third year or is this?
I think they had them before, but yes, last year was
the big one. Okay,
sort
so.
Of like the became a thing. Before
so
they
came right at the right
you know,
time.
There were some people I think they were putting it together and was kind of there, but this was no. This is it. Last year you could see this is going to blossom.
And years to come, you're going to see every floor filled with people. Like
admission's still the same price.
They have different, you know, you have to read this thing too. Look at the length of this stupid thing here. This event will draw over 125 exhibiting artists and vendors, as well as award-winning guest speakers who will offer lectures. and workshops and portfolio reviews. Or you need to know more than that. That's great.
How important would you say are portfolio reviews? I being an artist, I'm always afraid to, like, you have those legendary people like yourself, and I'm almost afraid to bring my stuff.
No.
To,
throw that fear in the garbage.
But it's like,
what do you get? Then what do you get? Nothing.
Yeah, you got
Most guys will lie to you because they're nice. Mm-hmm. And so they'll say things like, oh, well, you need to work on this, you need to work on that. That's not me. So I don't ever recommend anybody come to me. I will give somebody $20 not to show me their portfolio.
Wow.
Take $20, don't show me the portfolio. Just don't, please. You just made $20. Good.
But don't you think that brutal honesty is good for their soul? Like,
I don't know. I don't know, but I don't know how to do it any other way. Because I've watched it from my side, and I've watched it from other people's side. People use, I showed my stuff to people, and they would say this stuff, you know, and I'm listening, and it's like I'm trying to decipher it into English, and I don't understand it because they're saying things that I think I want to hear, but I don't want to hear. I worked in a, when I was 18, I worked in a, when I got out of school, within a few months, I worked in a studio that had four artists. Two of them were artists, drawing artists. The other two were retouchers. Anyway, so one of the guys that I was working for, a guy named Howard Notion, would say nice, pedantic things to me. Basically, he just wanted me to do work for him. Mm-hmm. And so I did, and that was fine. There was this other guy, Elmer Wexler, who worked in the other room, and he would leave work at 4:30, and he would go to Connecticut, where he had, you know, 2.5 kids and a wife and a Jaguar and, live the life, you know.
Wow.
And he was very organized, very, you know, pinstripe, not gray flannel suit, and just very organized. Ex-Marine.
Wow.
And good artist. But he was very, just, this is how you do it, okay? And this other guy that I was working for, he would sleep on the couch, and he would stay overnight, and he would go to see his family on the weekend because he was trying to get work done. He wasn't getting his work done. He would listen to jazz, and we would be listening to jazz all night, and I'd be staying up all night and crashing, and I'd wake up, take a nap in the corner somewhere, and wake up in the morning and do some more work. While this Elmer Wexler, he's over there, he comes in at 8:30 in the morning and leaves at 4:30 at night in the afternoon. Takes the train to Connecticut, drives his Jaguar to his house with his 2.5 kids and his wife. And it was totally different world. And I didn't understand this guy. I understood this guy because he was just a schmuck like me. Right? Just work hard and work hard and work hard and forget everything else and just work hard and that's it. And work hard. That's it. Anything else? No, just work hard. So this guy had a comic strip. It was based on the Batmasterson television show. And the strip failed. The show ended, and the strip failed. And I didn't make any damn money. I made like $9 a week. I took a percentage rather than get paid $50 a week. I took a percentage, which gave me $9 a week for 3 months. It was the dumbest thing I ever did in my life. No, I've done more dumb things. No, a lot of dumb things. So I'm doing all this work. And now it's gone. But while I was doing that work, he was doing some commercial stuff for advertising agencies, and I got in on that. So mm-hmm. I actually made money on that stuff. And I met some people through the studio that gave me other freelance work. So I was getting money, as my little notebook will show. But now this was ending. Mm. So there's this place called Johnstone & Cushing. They did comics for advertising. And they did cigarette ads. Back in the day, you did that. Anyway, so I did. I went home and I did this ad. And I needed to show it to somebody because I wanted to go to this place called Johnstone & Cushing that did this stuff and show them my work. But I had the Bat Masterson stuff, which was backgrounds and stuff, and I didn't have anything that I really did myself. Mm-hmm. And my schoolwork was just not quite up to snuff because in an advertising agency, they want to see Superman.
Yeah.
They want to see advertising guys smoking cigarettes and looking casual.
Cool cowboys. Yeah.
So I took my piece into Elmer Wexler because he was the hard nut, right? And to get his comment. So he looked at it and he said, for me to tell you what's wrong with this would take me 2 days. So I'm not going to comment on it.
Wow.
2 days. It's like a punch in the chest.
Like a whole 48 hours? It
would take me 2 days to tell you what's wrong with this. And I went home, and it's like, oh, he won't tell me what's wrong. That's how far I needed to come, that he wouldn't even tell me what's wrong with it. Hmm. Okay, I do better than that. I tell people what's wrong with it, but I'm saying he wouldn't even tell me, because he told me it would take me 2 days to tell you all the things that are wrong with it. So that meant that I had to learn what I didn't do right that would take 2 days to explain to me in order to do it right. So I sat down and I started to plan another ad. And I did the referencing, really deep referencing. I took some photographs. I did all the things that I felt he would have done if he could do the best job he could possibly ever do. And I did another ad. And I called him up and I said, look, I know you didn't like what I did. I'd like to show you another piece. He said, well, I don't know. I said, just you can say the same thing. Just I can just then leave, but I'd like to show you the new piece. I worked my ass up on it. Okay, I brought it in, and I gave it to him, and he looked at it. He said, He picked up the phone, and he called Tim Johnstone at Johnstone & Cushing, and he said, I'm sending this guy over to you. He can do work for you right away.
Wow, that's awesome. Like,
this is a no-shit guy. You know, I'm just like, wow. And I got the work. I went over there. They couldn't believe I was 18 years old. It was like, what the hell is this? Because I had done something that would have satisfied Elmer Wexler, wow, who was a professional artist, turning stuff out. And I got to do all the best stuff at Johnstone & Cushing.
So what happened the first time? What do you think was it?
It was a piece of shit.
Do you still have it? I was just wondering.
I have it. It's a total piece of shit. I know what's wrong with it. It's a piece of shit. I didn't put all.
Well, that didn't take 2 days.
No.
Okay. Hey, thank you for watching the video.
Did you like it?
Did you?
You probably just like the parts of me.
You really like.
But anyway, if you like that video, go ahead and hit that like and subscribe.
And if you don't, we have a bag of kittens with baseball. You know what's gonna happen.
We're gonna leave those kittens alone, you know, because we don't want any problems.